Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to let you know at the outset that I plan to follow what I think are the essential three B's of speech making. Be brief, be bright, be gone. I must thank Chrissy for her eloquent remarks. You know, she was an exemplary champion, celebrated for her willpower, her unwavering concentration, impeccable ball control, but Chrissy's memory of what she accomplished was, as she just acknowledged, a little bit clouded. And I think it was incumbent upon me to interrupt on a regular basis, to just set the record straight whenever she fielded questions about her career. Someone had to clarify those facts, it was up to me. Now, the reason I think that her memory was clouded was that she was a champion focused on the future. She didn't dwell on her achievements, how many titles she won, when she last played a particular opponent, or any individual accomplishment. But that was understandable. I was the historian, but she was a great player, and she knew what her priorities were, and I was to always think of the next major. But I do appreciate very much the mutual respect we've always had for each other, and I thank her for coming today. Now, I would not be at this podium right now without the unflagging support of four men who took me graciously under their wings. Three of these individuals, Herbert Warren Wing, Ted Tinling, and Jack Kramer, are no longer with us, although I'm convinced that they are here in spirit today. Wing was this nation's preeminent golf writer. We became close friends when he covered the U.S. Open tennis every year, and he was my biggest booster. Tinling was ubiquitous, a renowned dress designer and later chief of protocol at the Grand Slam events. Down through the vast corridors of time, Ted was an unimpeachable tutor for me and for many others. I met Kramer in 1972 when I was working as a statistician at CBS, and he was a commentator. He, in my view, was a man of the 20th century because of his multifaceted and far-reaching roles in tennis. And Jack told me frequently, "Kid, I like your thinking a lot. I'll help you any way I can." And did he ever help, much more than he ever knew. The same is true of my old friend Tony Traver, the former Hall of Fame president, champion player, and Davis Cup captain, whom I've known for more than 40 years. Now I'd like to just salute a couple of my fiercely steadfast allies through the years. This country's most multifaceted sports writer, Scott Price of Sports Illustrated, and the distinguished Brad Faulkner, formerly of the Tennis Channel. They have often believed in me more than I believe in myself, and I can say that very sincerely. Just by hanging around Price over the last couple of decades at the majors, my stock rose in my trade significantly. Scott has been my modern-day Herbert Warren Wing. These towering individuals did everything they could to enlarge my reputation, but I've had someone in my corner for all 65 years of my life who used his profound communicative skills to give me the best possible chance to succeed. My 93-year-old father, Stanley Flink, has been with me every single step of the way. Yes. And let me add, I made a bit of a mistake right there. Let me call him 93 years young. But I would not have landed here without his guidance. He was an outstanding journalist and broadcaster working for Time and Life, and writing on luminaries, including Marilyn Monroe, who once said that he was the nicest reporter she ever knew. He interviewed Hogan Roosevelt for the Today Show, covered Kennedy and Nixon on the campaign trail, and played doubles with none other than Bill Tilden in California less than a week after that before that legendary American died back in 1953. My gregarious father introduced me to Pancho Gonzalez, Stan Smith, Dick Savile, Billy Talbert, and many others. And in 1969, he brought me around to the press room at Wimbledon to meet a man who would become an indispensable mentor and colleague throughout my career, the renowned Bud Collins. I very seldom get the chance to publicly praise my father for the vital role he played in enhancing my career, but I very happily do so right now. Meanwhile, my wife Frances, son Jonathan, and daughter Amanda have been pillars by my side as I pursued this tennis obsession. I married Frances in 1979, and she's been my Hall of Famer. Now a gifted artist, she's masterfully organized, arranging our family life immaculately. Jonathan has admirably gone into the EMT field. 10 years ago, here in Newport, when Pete Sampras was inducted, I asked him to urge Jonathan to stop driving me bonkers by going for second serve aces. Sampras looked at my son sternly and said, give the other guy a chance to miss. Pete then nodded at me, thinking he'd succeeded. I asked my impish son later if he would change his audacious ways after listening to a champion he revered like no other. Jonathan said, not a chance. As for my daughter Amanda, now about to attend graduate school in France, she told me recently with characteristic sensitivity that she's envious I found a passion in tennis that has carried me with undiminished professional joy across more than four decades. Amanda would become exasperated as a kid when I would shout at the players and offer advice from my living room while watching sporting events on television. Dad, she would say, don't you understand? They can't hear you. What I do understand is the magnitude of this honor. Only 9 people have previously been inducted here, at least partially because they were writers. I learned immeasurably from many of them. John Barrett was a critical advisor. I joined forces alongside the erudite David Gray on daily sketches for the Wimbledon program and worked for the redoubtable Gladys Helmut of World Tennis and Gene Scott at Tennis Week, who both wrote penetrating editorials for years on end, imploring the game's movers and shakers to think out of the box. I've been one fortunate fellow witnessing the evolution of this sport from the mid-60s all the way up to today, from Rod Laver to Rafa Nadal, from Billie Jean King to Serena Williams, from wood rackets to the current frames. Tennis is the ultimate test of character in sports that puts a premium not only on physical durability, but also mental toughness and emotional equilibrium. In essence, it is a contact sport. My old friend John Roberts, the stylish former tennis correspondent for The Independent in London, told me recently, Steve, you have loved tennis longer than you can remember. You've expressed this passion through writing and broadcasting about the great and not so great at the major tournaments. Now here you are among the illustrious of the sport on an occasion that is one of the highlights of your life, receiving an honor which for you, in all humility, is like winning a Grand Slam championship. Roberts got to the heart of my feelings with that assessment. I'm a journalist first and foremost, but a part of me remains fundamentally and unabashedly a tennis fan. I stand here today immensely humbled, exhilarated, and gratified by this ineffable accolade. Thank you very, very much.